creepy.
Yeah, you like their photo?
I remember it, but don't remember exactly sure. it. But I just remember it being kind of creepy.
Yeah, we're in zombies.
Here we go.
I'm going to call the special meeting for Tuesday, November 1st for the Windsor Board of Education to order. If we could please stand for the pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence. Thank you. I just want to point out that Wynn TV will be broadcasting our Board of Education meeting live this evening on Channel 95. It's also being recorded and will be carried in future, at future times. And for the record, I'd like to state that Ms. Yvette Ali is actually out of state on business and will not be joining us here this evening. Moving on to agenda item number 2, audience to visitors. If anyone would want to address the board, they please come to the table, sign in, state your name and address for the record. You have 3 minutes to speak. Just a reminder that no remarks can or comments can be made against employees of Windsor Public Schools. So at 30 seconds remaining, Mr. Lockhart will hold up the red card and keep it up at the 3 minutes. With that, audience to visitors is open. Seeing none, we'll close audience to visitors. We're at agenda item number 3. Presentation on nutritional guidelines and food service. This was a requested item of board member Brian Bosch last year. This was our first opportunity to bring this forward during our special meeting. So I'd like to turn it over to, I guess, Mrs. Batchelder or Mrs. Plant or Dr. Cook, if you want to do any introduction, by all means.
Sure, just as they're coming forward, you hit the nail on the head. It's Ms. Batchelder and Ms. Plant that would be presenting tonight, and this is in response to a request from about a year ago to review food service in Windsor and healthy foods requirements and certifications and all we do with that for our students. So I know there's been a lot of work put into tonight's presentation, so I'm excited to turn it over to Ms. Dana Plant and Ms. Danielle Batchelder.
Hello, I'll just introduce Dana real quick. Dana Plant is our food service director. She put a wonderful PowerPoint presentation together for the group tonight to fully explain our food service program, different guidelines, state guidelines, federal guidelines that we have to follow, so everyone is aware of why we do what we do, and she will get into it more, but I just absolutely love it. She brought sample meals that are served at our high school, and it was actually the menu today. So please, after the presentation, go and check it out, and it's the same sample size as our students receive. So no further ado, all you there.
Thank you very much. So this is just going to help explain the type of programs that we run here in the public schools, and they are USDA federally funded programs run through the State Department of Ed. So we run the National School Lunch Program, which was founded in 1946 by President Harry Truman. And whenever anybody knows why it was started, they're all like, wow, I have no idea. It was started because when we were in war, we needed troops, and they were going to enlist, and it was discovered that they were malnourished. So President Truman signed into an act, School Lunch Act, to provide nutritionally balanced, low-cost, or free lunches to children every day, so that we could be better prepared as a nation. I mean, that just kind of blew me away when I realized that 24 years ago. And we still run those same programs today. And the school breakfast program was established in 1966. We also run that program in all of our Windsor Public Schools. And they have evolved since their inception. The same goals remain the same, to provide healthy meals to our children so that they're ready and able to learn. In 2010, President Obama and Michelle Obama spearheaded the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act. It took quite a few years and a lot of effort to roll it out. It's still rolling out. We haven't seen the total act in its entirety in our programs just yet. It'll be 2017 and then again in 19, I think, when the final guidelines are set forth to us. Quite frankly, industry could not keep up with the changes that they put in the program. So it was to combat childhood obesity, by the way, which was on the rise in our nation. But Connecticut was ahead of Mrs. Obama. We had already gone to our legislators and said that we needed to have healthy foods in our schools. And so we spearheaded it here in Windsor, actually. And we are part of a healthy food certified district since its inception in 2010. So we actually get additional funds through the State Department of Ed because we are a healthy food certified district. And these are the towns in the state in the green that participate in the healthy foods, okay? So we actually get an extra 10 cents per lunch served because we are healthy food certified. And that's a lot of money. Somewhere in the vicinity of $45,000 to $50,000 a year because we choose to only provide healthy snacks and healthy foods, okay? I guess I kind of got a little ahead of myself. So every lunch served in our program, we get the 10 cents. Okay, last year we got just under 50,000, okay? Because we're healthy food certified. We also get, it's called 6 cents certification. That again was kind of a grueling task we had to go through. We had to certify to the federal government that all of our meals were in total compliance. And if you did that, they rewarded you with an extra 6 cents per meal. So you can see we don't operate on, you know, large margins, but every penny helps. So with the 10 cents with the healthy food and the 6 cents with the 6 cent certification, Windsor is receiving an extra 16 cents per meal served, just based on, you know, going a little over and above. So Smart Snacks was put forth through the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act in school year 13-14. But if you recall, I said Connecticut already did it. So there was nothing for us to do. Our guidelines are actually more stringent than that of the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act. So, and you don't have a choice with that. And you don't get any extra funding. So it was kind of a bonus for Connecticut. Okay. Okay, so just to pick apart some of the pieces of the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act, all of our grains must be whole grain. And so this took a lot of time for industry to catch up. We found it very difficult for the first year or two to get things that students would eat. Do we all remember whole wheat pasta when it first came out in the grocery stores? It was really dark colored, grainy, I'm Italian, I can't do wheat pasta.
And very expensive originally when it came out.
And very expensive, yes. And it didn't really taste very good. Okay, it didn't really matter how much you cooked it, it still wasn't very tasty. But it's come a long way. So we actually have a lasagna roll up here that uses a whole grain, it's called white wheat. And industry did come out with that. ConAgra Foods, you know, one of our biggest processors in the nation, came out with a white wheat flour. Sorry, so kids don't really know they're eating whole wheat because the coloration of it looks just like white flour. Okay, so we have transformed most of our products, Goldfish crackers, graham crackers, pizza crust, pastas. So the Goldfish you buy in the grocery store is not whole grain, but the Goldfish that we give here for our students is 100% full grain. Now it tastes maybe a little bit different, but it's all what you get used to, okay? And it complies. Okay. Sodium was probably the biggest phase in for us. And this was a huge challenge for us because, again, industry could not keep up. We couldn't get product that fit in the sodium levels. So the entire meal for the kids, it has to be 1,260, excuse me, for 6 to 8, or 1,420. And as you can see, it's gonna go down to 640, 710, and 740. It's gonna be cut in half by the time they're done. That's huge. I don't know. For people that don't cook with salt, you're used to it. But if you do cook with salt, you're gonna miss it. So again, that's why it's such a slow phase in, to try to get people's palates used to it, okay? Milk must be 1% for skim or white, and it must be fat-free if it's flavored. So we offer fat-free chocolate, strawberry, and 1% white. We did the skim, but not many took it, so they much prefer the flavors if they're gonna be fat-free. We must have fresh fruits and vegetables on every lunch and breakfast tray. That too is part of the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act, and that's been a challenge. So when a student comes through the lunch line with their tray, if they don't have a fruit or a vegetable on their tray, because they're allowed to choose, we have to say, you have to have a piece of fruit on your tray, or we can't let you go by. And then they might say, I'm not gonna eat it. And then we have to say, try it, you might like it. Take an apple, take it home. End of the week, have mom make applesauce, apple pie, something. You try to get them to take it home. There's a lot of waste. So we have tried in all the schools, we put up a second chance tray, table, basket, whatever, and every building is something different. And so if you aren't gonna eat your apple, instead of throwing it in the garbage, put it in the basket. Maybe somebody that needs that apple, wants to take it home, has after school sports, doesn't have a chance to get something to eat, they can take the apple, okay? Vegetable subgroups, requiring a minimum number of servings every week. This again was kind of a nightmare. They must have these vegetables every week in the Monday through Friday menu. So obviously the challenge is the beans. And it was kind of funny that they kept it to a half a cup of starchy, which of course starchy is potato, until the people from Maine and Idaho went crazy and said, oh my gosh, schools are our biggest venue. We sell the most potatoes in schools and prisons. And now you're saying schools can only have a half a cup once a week. You can't do this. You're gonna put our farmers out of business. So they backtracked. They can have it as many times as we need, you know, we want this now, if they have, you know, gotten away from just the half a cup. And then 9 to 12, it's a total of 5 cups of vegetables a week. We don't use any canned vegetables here in Windsor. Everything is fresh or frozen. And this is the breakdown of the groups. And it's kind of horrifying when you look. They have to have so many dark green every week. And when you see the choices, it's kind of tough. There's not a lot of, you know, kind of what blew me away here, and I won't spend a lot of time on this, but you have to have red-orange vegetables. So I thought, I love beets. Beets go great on salads. Red vegetable, beets. I don't know about you, but I don't see beets under red-orange. And I thought to myself, where's beets? How come there's no beets? Beets is under other. It doesn't count as a red vegetable. I'm like, okay. Somebody's playing tricks here. How can a red beet not count as a red vegetable? Superfood, great for you, doesn't count as a red vegetable. It counts as like a nothing. Don't understand it, I just follow the rules. So. Okay, so the main changes for the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act of 2010 were the calorie ranges. So this is what guides our menu, okay? So we are allowed to give students from K to 5 between 550 and 650 calories per lunch. And it has to be met in these subgroups. 1 to 2 ounces of meat, meat alternate. Meat alternate would be like yogurt, okay? That would be like a meat alternate. Or tofu if we did it, but we don't do the tofu. 1 to 2 grains, totaling 8 to 9 a week. 3/4 of a cup of vegetable, 1/2 cup of fruit, and 1/8 ounce of milk. And then of course, 6 to 8
you bump up to 600 to 700 calories. There's the breakdown. And 9 to 12 is 750 to 850, and the breakdown. I know we had a lot of concern at the high school level when we went to this Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act. Kids were saying we're not getting enough food, we're hungry. USDA says this is the calorie range we have to stay in, and it's very difficult. Some menus we're within 1 or 2 calories. We serve a meal, this is just a side note. We serve a meal at all the schools, and it's French toast sticks, and it's chicken sausage, because we don't use any pork products. So it's chicken sausage, French toast sticks, hash brown, milk, fruit, okay? Kids love it. It's their favorite, it's their number one meal that we serve. Brunch for lunch, we call it, okay?
I'm well,
we can't do it at the high school because the meal is over 5 calories. Because the little syrup cup that you can get put the meal over for 5 calories. So you say to yourself, well, Dan, give them a few less potato. I can't, because it has to be 1 cup of fruit, 1 cup of veg. Has to be so many ounces of grain, so many ounces of protein. I can't change anything on the food. My only place was the syrup cup. So I got so excited. I found a log cabin light syrup cup. No artificial sweetener, because that's not allowed. And oh my gosh, it's 60 calories. It's 5 calories less than the other syrup cup that we use. It's a lot more money, but I don't care. I'm using it because the kids love this meal. So I had a special ordering. 20 cases came in yesterday. They called and said, the syrup cup is 65 calories. Online, it says it's 60. Okay, Dana went into orbit, and Dana called Heinz and Kraft, because they own Log Cabin. And I said to the guy, do you realize your nutritional info on the website is 60, but the box says 65? He goes, you're kidding. No. Am I the only person that's ever noticed this disparity here? And he's like, I am going to get back to you. And I'm like, yeah, you are. Because now that meal doesn't work. So elementary, we offer 1 hot, 1 cold, middle, 1 hot, and 4 to 6 cold options. We have a kind of an extensive deli. And high school, 2 hot, and I have the samples here. 2 hot, which is a sandwich deli, a salad deli, at the high school level. Okay. We are reinstating, we did this a while back, we called it Lunch Bunch, but now we're reinstating. I've spoken to Principal Asunday about having a representative group of students that will commit to 4 times a year. We're gonna bring in vendors, have a little mini vendor fair, have them taste test, get their input. What I might like may not be what they like. So you can't go by my 60-year-old taste buds. You have to go by young people and what they like. I don't like hot and spicy food, but I'm not the norm, I'm told. Everybody loves hot and spicy but me. So you can't go by me, so we're gonna get the students involved. Best way to do it. So they changed the food service as we know it, now 5 years into the nutrition standards. Students are more receptive to our menus. So I called USDA when this first came out, and I said, we're seeing a lot of waste. We're seeing the kids just throw this stuff away. It's a sin, it's a crime, it's terrible. You know, are you guys doing anything about this? We're forcing them to take a fruit, and they just take it, and they pop it right in the trash. And the answer I was told, California, they actually put cameras on their trash barrels just to show USDA the waste. And USDA's response was, we know we are wasting millions and millions and millions of dollars a year on school food being thrown away, but it's going to take 7 to 10 years before we see it turn around. So it's a generational, you're going to have to grow up with this type of eating, type of food. So we haven't quite seen it yet, but we're getting there. Okay. My Plate, they developed, remember the old pyramid, food guide pyramid, everybody, well, now it's called My Plate. So we have these up in all the schools, you might have seen them if you were in the buildings at all. And it shows kids that, vegetables should be the biggest part, but the grain and the fruit and the protein not so much, and just to have a nice, well-balanced meal. By food groups, as the My Plate just showed, protein, dairy, grain, veg, and fruit. We have to do something called offer versus served. We offer all five to the child. They must take 3 out of 5, and one must be a fruit or a veg. So, in order to get the funding that we get per meal. Prior to this, the student could take 3 components, but they weren't required to have the fruit or vegetable. So at the high school level, a piece of pizza and a milk was considered a full meal. 3 components. Grain, cheese is the protein, milk. That was considered a full meal. Now you have to have a fruit or a veg on there. And that really impacted us, because we had a lot of kids that just wanted to take the main, you know, entree and a milk. Okay, so breakfast is 4 components, protein, grain, and those are interchangeable items, fruit and vegetable, and dairy. Okay, so we have to offer all 4 to the child, they must take 3 out of 4, and 1 must be the fruit. And this was an addition in 2015, having a vegetable, fruit added. I know you probably think that's kind of funny, but they actually say you should put carrots out at breakfast or celery sticks out at breakfast. We don't do that, we, you know, try to just stick with the fruits. We are part of the CLOCK program. You might see it on our financials that we hand in every month. And that stands for Commodity Letter of Credit. And sometimes it stands for Cash in Lieu of Commodities. I think it changes, I don't know. In my brain it changes, it's interchangeable. But it was a pilot program from USDA over 30 years ago. And we are one of 13 districts in the country. It was grueling paperwork, and the food service director way back did the paperwork, and our district has gotten grandfathered in. We are the envy of the state because we don't get the brown box commodities that you might hear of other districts that they get. So they might get brown box chicken or chicken in a can or different cheeses, or they get all those canned fruits and vegetables. We don't. We get the cash, and we spend it on what we want to, the product that we want. We have to spend it on what they tell us. So we just got our second quarter clocks in, and I was told I have to spend an additional $16,000 on beef. So I can't spend that $16,000 on carrots. I must prove I've spent it on beef. That won't be a problem, trust me, but I have to spend that money on beef. So they earmark what it has to be spent on, and they do monitor it. We have to send in the proof, our invoices. And we have a separate checking account for it so that, you know, the auditors take a look at it. We make sure what comes in goes out. And so we're very lucky in that regard. The quality of our food is better than the average bear. Okay. So our CLOCK program in school year 15-16, we received $134,498 to spend. So USDA allocates 0.3125 cents per lunch. That's how they come up with the amount that they send us. So they look at the previous year's lunch. This year, we are gonna receive $173,000 based on the amount of lunches we served last year. You might say, wow, that's a big jump. We took on a new school last year. We are doing the food for CREC, Aerospace and Engineering. And so just by taking on that school, it increased our CLOCK monies by just shy of $40,000, okay? So we can order weekly commercial foods for delivery, not monthly commodity deliveries. Other districts in the state, they get tractor trailers showing up and they have to, you know, 5,000 cases of chicken show up at their doorstep and they have to have warehouse freezers. We don't. We can get our food as needed. We operate a summer school food service program since 2013. We've expanded. We had 5 sites this year, and it's been very well received. We've had a lot of good positive feedback. These are some of the numbers. I go to the HAT meetings, the Hunger Action Team meetings here in Windsor, and I couldn't go to the last meeting. I was tied up in something. So they put this together for the meeting. So it was actually kind of good, so I thought, oh, we should put it in here. So these are, you can see how many more meals we have every year we've increased. We do farm to school here. Not as much as, you know, we are going to try to do next year. You know, we take little baby steps every year. So we got apples, we didn't get them this year, they weren't that good this year. But we generally get them every year from Raw Orchard off of Kennedy Road. Our milk supplier this year is, the milk is produced in New Britain and it comes from a local farmer here in Bloomfield, Maple Hill. Early in the school year, I ordered a bunch of stuff from Newgate Farms on Prospect Hill. Their produce was amazing. So I've already, you know, set it up for next year for us to get their produce, you know, tomatoes, peppers, squash for next year. You know, if you tell them, they'll grow for you. And so that's what we're gonna do. And this year we picked up over 2,000 seed pods from Miracle-Gro, donated from Miracle-Gro for the Hunger Action Team and Food Share. And so it's my understanding that they're gonna be used in the classrooms. And the kids are gonna get to grow, I know I saw basil and spinach, and the kids are gonna get to grow these things from a donation from Miracle-Gro. Okay, so some of the initiatives, some of the things we've changed over the years. I met with a group of students from Windsor High School that did a whole study on styrofoam trays and recycling. So we don't necessarily recycle on the spot on our styrofoam trays, but they are taken to the transfer station and then they are removed and recycled. So we don't do the recycling necessarily, but they are recycled. But it made me think about what can we do differently. And so we went from a 5-compartment styrofoam tray to a paper food container. For those of you that go to fairs, you know, you see the boat and sometimes it has french fries and nachos in it, it's red plaid. Mm-hmm. We use those. And those are paper, they're just very lightly coated so they biodegrade much faster. And they are totally sufficient for all of our breakfast. So we don't use any styrofoam trays in breakfast at all anymore. Based on what these kids brought to me, and I was like, you know, kind of makes you scratch your head and say, mm-hmm. Yeah, you know what? Let's take a look at this. So it's cheaper than the 5-compartment foam. And it's safer for the environment, so it's really a good thing. And some of the other things that we have done is World Language Week at Sage Park. We have done special foods for them, Metropolitan Learning Center. We do every year, we do a West African menu for them. Read Across America, we do for the elementaries, the green eggs and ham. And we were one of the first districts to incorporate all nutritional information on our menus. So if you look at any of our menus, everything is right there. The nurses love it because they can see exactly what is in every food item being served. When we went to the open houses, the parents were really quite happy. I brought samples of lunches there as well, and they were like, wow, this is what the kids get. Then they were like, Joey, why don't you get lunch? Why do I have to pack? This looks like a really nice lunch. So it was really good. People need to see it. That's why I brought it here today. So we do breakfast in the classroom at some of the elementary schools. And I applied for a grant, and we got it. And it was a $4,000. It came from the local milk farmers. And so what we were able to purchase is a cart, a breakfast cart, movable cart, that we have in the lobby of JFK, and it's worked out beautifully. The kids come in right off the bus, they get in line, punch in their PIN number, grab their breakfast, get in line, go to class, and they can eat their breakfast in a leisurely fashion and not have to rush through it. So we started at Kennedy as a pilot, and now we're doing it at Ellsworth and Clover, and it allows children to get their breakfast on the go. And I think that's it. Anybody has any questions?
It's pretty thorough there. Thank you very much. We'll start with questions. Mr. Lesser?
Yes, I got a comment, two questions. One, the lunch advisory committee. Mm-hmm. I think we had a student rep that was on this board before that really mentioned the fact that he would love for students to have an opportunity to meet with the principal and the staff to really give their input. So I'm very, very pleased that we're seeing this part of the presentation. My first question is, what happens to the food daily? We live in a very blessed town, but unfortunately we do have people that are hungry and need to be able to eat. And what I don't want to hear is that we have food and it's being thrown away. Are we rationing that food at the end of the day to a local soup kitchen or a food share, something where it can be put to really, really good use?
Unfortunately, we do not. I actually looked into this probably 7 to 10 years ago. I contacted the Board of Health and I said, is there a way we can recapture some of the food that we don't sell for the day? And they said, no, the risk liability, it far outweighs. And I said, well, what if we, you know, put it right in the freezer and then had it picked? And they said, no, they just shut it right down. Absolutely not. It's the transport, that's the problem. Because unless, you know, I can certify that that food went from 160 degree hot holding, didn't get served, and now I've cooled it, you know, to 45 degrees in less than 2 hours, and then it's been transported somewhere under that 45 degree temperature, it can't happen.
Like
they
I know,
just.
Like I know from personal experience, I know during this season, straight to the spring, people along the tree line at Stroll Park, different areas where they're actually living underneath the brush during the winter, take food to them. So to see that type of food going to waste, just there's got to be a solution somehow, some way we come put our heads together and find a way to, you know, reallocate that food some way somehow.
If it'll ease your mind a little bit, in the elementary level, we only cook 10 meals over what is ordered, shall we say. The little kids order. So when the teacher takes attendance, they have a lunch form in the classroom. And so, you know, Joey brought lunch from home, so they check home, and then so-and-so wants a cold lunch or a hot lunch. Those slips are collected, and the cook counts everything up and says, okay, we need 62 cold lunches today and 180 hot lunches today. So she makes 190 hot, because there's always that child that came in late, or if they drop it, they spill, whatever. We make 10 extra in the hot, and one or two extra in the cold, and that's it. So generally, there's not a lot of leftover or waste. And so at the middle high school level, we do what we call batch cooking. So you know, you cook, if you know you're serving 500 hot meals, you know, you make sure that first wave, there's 150 hot meals ready to go. Second wave, you know by your previous numbers, because we do a 4-week cycle menu. So you know by your previous numbers that that second wave, we're gonna need probably 110 hot meals. Because kids are creatures of habit, you know, they like that meal, they're gonna order it again and again. So we'll cook and make sure we have 120. That last wave, that's where it takes a little bit of expertise. You have to know when to pull the trigger, so to speak. When to put that last pan in the oven, because you know it's gonna take, that oven is screaming hot, you know it's gonna take 11 minutes for it to cook. So you hold off if you think you have enough. You know, you don't wanna run out, but you don't wanna overcook either. So oftentimes what'll happen is they might put it in the oven to cook, and then they see kids changing their mind or whatever, they'll shut that oven down and get it quick back in the freezer fast, or they'll use it the next day. So we try to really try to not waste food. That's kind of a thing from, you know.
My final question is nutrition for the athletes at the high school and the middle school. I'm looking at these maximum calorie intakes for lunch. Not a lot, considering if you didn't put them through a rigorous practice or through competition. Is there any collaboration with the athletic director on any recommendations on how to allow them any additional intake to prepare for practice and or games?
Not in the USDA program. We do sell snacks, a la carte things. So a student could buy a bagel and cup of peanut butter, or they could buy fruit, or they could buy, you know, whole grain, you know, cinnamon twist rolls and stuff, and you know, whatever. And they're all part of the healthy snack, okay? So they're not full of fat or whatever. that wouldn't be good for them. But not in the USDA program. They're very strict. You have to follow those calories. And we actually brought that to them as well, and we said, you know, you might have a 6'2", you know, linebacker, you know, coming in and he wants to eat, he's hungry. He could eat, you know, 4 pieces of pizza himself and what have you, and they just kind of look at you and say, nope, these are the guidelines. So it's unfortunate.
They are able to buy a portion of the meal, though.
They can get an extra a la carte entree. the day of the meal. So in other words, if I'm serving French bread pizza, like in the Stoker's French bread pizza, if I'm serving that for lunch with salad and vegetable, another vegetable and a milk and a piece of fruit, and that meal is $3, that student for another $1.25 can buy an extra piece of pizza, but only one. They can only buy one extra. Okay. So I mean, it is a little bit of a help, but you can't have that every day. You have to, you can only serve the extra entree for what the meal is planned for that day. I can't serve pizza every day as an extra.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Shepard.
And thank you for this presentation. Just have two questions. In regards to the GLAAP funding.
The GLAAP fund, yeah.
So how is that calculated each year? Is it based on the number of students per building? Is it based on the number of schools in our district? Just how do we arrive at the number that's sent to us?
It's based on the previous year's lunches served. So I do a state report for the Connecticut State Department of Ed because they're the vehicle where I get the federal funds from. And so I do that report for them every month, and I report every building, how many lunches, breakfast, snack, because we do the snack program, how many meals were served. And then based on their calculations of total meals for the school year, that drives the funds for the following year.
And you may have mentioned this. If you did, I apologize. So it says here that we are grandfathered in, so this is just something that's ongoing. So
they have said they are never taking this away. Okay. They actually would like to implement it throughout the country. I'm not quite sure, you know, where the stumbling block is, but they've been looking to do it for many, many years, but they're not taking it away. And to my knowledge, they're not increasing it either. It's great. It's great. I mean, I don't know if any of you heard, you know, maybe 3-4 years ago, Boston had a problem. Their USDA commodity foods, they had warehouses the size of our high school that held food. Well, nobody rotated it. Nobody made sure there were no vermin in there. Next thing you know, somebody went in to get peaches. The cans were all rusty. The cans were old, outdated, exploding because they weren't air conditioned. You know, food likes to live where we live. Food doesn't want to be in a warehouse that's 120 degrees. Food wants to be in 70 degree temperature, just like me. And it didn't happen. They didn't air condition it because it costs a lot of money. And all that food had to be destroyed. And then, of course, it was a big thing. How do you destroy all this food? You can't just take it to a landfill, because then somebody could go there and say, oh my gosh, look at these peaches. Who threw these away? And next thing you know, you got some I-team reporter coming, you know, Boston City Schools threw away good peaches. So now it becomes a problem. How do you throw it away? How do you get rid of it? It's challenging.
Thank you. And then in the piece about the farm to school, I just think that's really amazing that in a community, you know, they always say that schools are of a community, but the community being in the school is always something that you want to lift up. So I'm just always wondering, how do we share this with the larger community that we are really being intentional about the farm to school? So just want to say thank you for that, and also that I really think that should be stated somewhere very clearly, you know, something that we lift up across our district of being in the community and of the community, because I didn't know that, and I'm a parent. I had no idea that we were receiving these items from Thrall Orchard or from Newgate Farm. So I think that's really impressive and a piece that our community would love to hear about. Living in an age where everybody's concerned about what's organic, making sure that our children are not being filled with these other fillers and steroids and everything else. This is a piece we really want to get out to our community. So if we can find a way to lift that up in our communications, you know, highlight it maybe at an open house night, I don't know. But this is really just awesome. I love the farm to school.
Thank you. Well, and I know Toshia and I had a conversation in a hallway the very first time I met her. And I kind of was, I got so excited. I was like, oh my gosh, like I had somebody new that I could like grab up and say, okay, so like we could do a field trip and you could get all the little kids to go to Thrall Orchard and then they would know these where our apples came from.
Absolutely.
I know, Terrell. I'm like, oh my gosh, I get kind of excited over food. But I thought that's a great way to do it. You take the little kids and you show them. Some kids don't know where these fruits come from. They just, kiwi, what's that? So wouldn't it be great if we could actually take them to the farm, because I'm pretty sure they could probably walk from Oliver Ellsworth. and go to Troll Orchard, and it's right across the street, and, you know, see the apple trees, and see this is where your apples are coming from. Mm-hmm. So I was excited to know that I had somebody that maybe we can try to implement this before it's time for me to say goodbye, and, you know, maybe it'll live on.
Thank you. I had one more, but I can wait.
So can I just piggyback? One of the things I know we do monthly is we put out the menus. Perhaps a thought is, and I know the menus are packed with already required information, but, you know, this month we're serving apples from Thrall Orchard, even if it's a one-liner to highlight our community local farms. So if you know that's something that month we are getting produce or whatever, maybe just add in a one line is at least one small way for us to communicate right. that.
One thing I do want to mention, just on that local produce. Mm-hmm. So if you see a Cisco truck or Thurston Foods, because those are our two food purveyors pulling up, they still have our local produce on their trucks. Mm-hmm. It, you know, I get a list every week of all the local produce that they have to offer, and I always choose local. So although it's coming on a Cisco truck, it's still local. You know, we have that beautiful farmer's market in Hartford, and, you know, that's where the farmers take their goods, and it gets distributed from there. So I am a little bit remiss on putting it on the menu and letting people know, but good thought.
Mr. Bosch?
Thanks for coming out. I really appreciate the passion that you have for this, too. It's really nice. I know President Santos said this was my request originally, and it might have taken you by surprise, but, you know, this is a great presentation and the passion. And before asking questions, just to piggyback on what other people are saying, I was also thinking that we can highlight some of this somehow. I know we send out newsletters just, you know, some of the things we are doing with food, because we have a nice program here. To piggyback on some of the other things, I don't have any questions so much as just maybe what you'd call an elaboration request. For the farms to food, farms to school, we're just talking about, you said there's going to be more next year. Like, where do you see us growing on that one? Is there things in the work for next year?
Yes. I've already had the conversation with the Newgate Farms owners. Excuse me. And because we tried it this year, we tried, I said, okay, send me 3 cases of tomatoes, send me this many squash and what have you. And we thought the quality was fabulous. And so we talked and I said, okay, can you grow? Because I'm gonna need, you know, cherry tomatoes, cases and cases of cherry tomatoes for our salads every week. I caught him off guard this year when I said, can you send me 10 cases of cherry tomatoes? No, I can't send you 10 cases. But it's already in his head. He knows what he's going to plant next year to help satisfy a need that we have, because he's just as happy to peddle his wares in Windsor schools as he is anywhere else in town. So it is in the works, yes. So we can possibly even do some lettuces, but for sure, peppers, tomatoes, cucumbers, squashes, even some eggplant.
Yeah, you're making me hungry.
Uh-oh.
You know, these are awesome things, too. When we're talking about the education, I'll kind of skip my questions. You know, I do wonder if our students could see an eggplant and know what it is, you know, just see those foods. But on initiatives, you know, one of the initiatives here is during World Language Week, apparently, we do some special menu items. I also see our cafeterias as a place to further education, as you see them as well. And I think the World Language Week's a nice tie-in. I don't know if there's opportunities to make other tie-ins, like, you know, social studies, you're doing a unit on Greece, and it's an opportunity to have maybe some falafel or some food that, you know, it's an education for a student. You already hit on other educational opportunities of, you know, taking kids out to a farm. I don't know if there's any elaboration on, you know, other folks working with you or using the cafeteria as, it is just one additional place for students to get education during their day.
You're absolutely right. USDA has actually started some more initiatives. They're just in their infancy. Cafeteria as a classroom is kind of what their focus is. So they are interested in having districts bring kids in, and so that they can see, you know, spaghetti sauce to little kids. It just comes out of a can. But they need to know that it started as a tomato and that somebody blanched it. You know, it's a process, it's called concassé, okay? So you put a little X at the top and an X at the bottom and you blanch it, shock it in cold water. It's called concassay, and next thing you know, the skin falls right off, and you've got a beautiful tomato ready to make a sauce, okay? Kids need to know that, not just the kids that go into culinary school. So, you know, it's something that I do think, you know, there's a place for it. I'm just not sure how to make it happen in Windsor just yet.
And for a final question, I'll be back to the food waste, and I already do like what you said. You know, I know we have these requirements to give out the food now, even if the students aren't going to eat them. I like that we have this table where we can, you know, if someone doesn't want their banana, they can leave it for somebody else. With that said, there's still substantial food waste. Do we separate food waste from other waste in the cafeteria and maybe use that in other ways? Or?
We don't at this point. I mean, I will tell you, I was at the high school one morning at breakfast, and I saw a bunch of kids like throw, and I was like, no! I found myself like, wanted to go into the trash barrel, and I was like, okay, Dana, no, step back. You can't do that. That is not good. And I just had to walk away, and, you know, it isn't a good thing to ever go into the trash and pick something out. So we're trying to get the kids to understand, leave it here. It's really okay. Somebody else might want it or need it. Don't throw it away. Because if you can eliminate the trash barrel and just put it here, then absolutely, some of it can go to the, you know, as long as it is doesn't need refrigeration, it could either stay there until the student came by to take it. It could go to the nurse's office. You know, if we have crackers, the goldfish or pretzels or something like that, go to the nurse's office. We have a kid coming in with a tummy ache, I'm hungry. Guess what? Now the nurse has some snacks to give them. But if it goes in the trash, we don't go in and go after it. So, I'm just have to get used to putting it on the table.
Ms. Bissell?
Thank you for the presentation. I still remember I just got to the high school my freshman year in 2001, and it's when they were doing the renovations in the cafeteria,
mm-hmm.
and that year we got an entire tray full of French fries. And then at the end of the school year, the last day of school, the thing was to go and buy as many cookies as you could possibly fit into your backpack. Because you could get, like, what, 4 for $1, I think it was? And that was, like, it was just epic. So to see the change in the way that we regulate, because it is actual federal regulation, kind of the offerings of our food, our school system offers in for food, and then it's kind of disappointing, but I understand and can appreciate kind of the rules that you must follow in order to kind of comply with those regulations. Because I do hear that, like, you know, to be able to get that, you know, those cents, it does add up.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's going to be important, especially for our students who aren't, who don't have the means and the resources through their family to be able to afford lunch and even breakfast. So thank you for that work. I know it probably takes a lot of time. So I did have a question. So I do observe that all of the apples are wrapped in plastic bags, and I was wondering if you could just speak to that, because it does seem a bit wasteful.
I agree. Our Board of Health is making it mandatory. If the fruit does not have a natural skin to be peeled, vis-a-vis an orange or a banana,
okay,
we must wash, remove the sticker, and individually wrap it. That's our Board of Health. They make us do that. I kind of, you know, said, well, we wash it. Can't we just put it in, you know, tell the kids only touch one? No. No. They make us put lids on everything. There's a lot of places where we could maybe reduce,
yeah.
You know, the fruit cup.
Yeah,
I have to put a lid. I have to put a lid. That's not me. That's not, you know, our workers would love to not have to put a lid. Board of Health have to have a lid. But we have sneeze guards. That's why we have sneeze guards. Nope, put a lid. They're so cautious. They make us do it.
That makes sense. I think it speaks to maybe something that is our obligation. I think that's how we see it as members of the Board of Education, to kind of engage in these conversations to see what we can do in order to kind of engage in a dialogue, I think, at the state level to seek efficiencies in food service. Because because it does seem absolutely wasteful. Especially if the majority of those fruits, because I have lunch quite regularly in the school, and are not actually being eaten. So thank you for that as well. I would like to also ask if there could be a little bit more promotion of, I think you called it the second chance.
Mm-hmm.
You said that it's different from school to school. I would really appreciate if that could be promoted more widely, because I haven't heard of that. As a parent, I thought that I would definitely hear about that, especially eating lunch with my son at school. And like this idea of, you had said that there was a response that's going to take 7 to 10 years. So we're kind of on the cusp of that,
mm-hmm.
given how much work you've done over the last almost decade now, right, to be able to get us kind of in compliance with these regulations and ahead, it seems like. So thank you for that. We should kind of be seeing that change. So if we could maybe promote that in our elementary schools a little bit more, could just to get our younger kids thinking about that, of like, even if the individual grabs apples, right? I mean, what a great idea to, what a great opportunity to have, like, maybe the K kids, right, collect those apples in the second chance basket at the end of the day and bring them to the Windsor Food Pantry or, you know, other social service organizations that kind of can, you know, be that kind of the facilitator of collecting those foods, those fruits, and bringing them to individuals who might benefit from having access to that. So. Thank you, though, so much for the work that you do. I really appreciate it.
Before I move on to more questions, can you just clarify the Board of Health that requires we put these apples in the bag? Is that Windsor Board of
yes.
Health or State?
Windsor.
The Windsor Board of Health.
Do they come?
So, do you need my permit?
Hold on, I think we may have more questions. Do you have another additional question?
Yeah, So is there the Windsor Board? This is a new area for me. I haven't looked into that. So it's just kind of coming to mind is how is the Windsor Board of Health regulated? Like, do they make their own regulations, or do they have to comply with state regulations?
They're governed by the state.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Public Health.
Okay, Department of Public Health.
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. O'Reilly?
Yes, just a quick question. I was wondering in the high school, if there's any high school students who help prepare the food as part of any culinary classes?
We don't. Years ago, we did. We had a few students come in, but again, it became challenging as to their food safety handling practices, and if they weren't being watched, or Board of Health were coming in and they saw, you know, a student doing something that would not be appropriate, and it just became difficult for us to try to manage it, so we don't.
Thank you. Mrs. Shepherd.
So thank you for answering my third question, and Ms. Bissell brought that up, because for me, I'm a self-proclaimed germaphobe, and I know that. So so that was my question with the second chance fruit. Like, how are we minimizing the spread of anything that's communicable in our schools? So thank you for sharing that. Yes, the fruit cups do have a lid, because yes, I equip my son with like hand sanitizer. My husband tells me often I'm going to die of a common germ, but that's okay. But thank you for sharing that. Thank you for sharing that, because that was a question for me. I was like, oh no, what is happening? The second chance fruit, you know, the kids touch it, oh my goodness. But I get it, and I do understand making sure that we have the efficiencies, because I get it. Like, if we don't need to necessarily use the plastic wrap on some of the fruits, so I get it. But I was just like, oh no, Danielle is laughing. I was like, oh, oh, but I get it, I completely get it. So thank you for sharing that, and thank you for bringing that up, Ms. Bissell. My last question, in regards to the food vendors, who's the vendor at the high school currently, as far as food?
Okay, so our groceries, as I call mm-hmm. it, we go out to bid every year,
okay.
And it's a one school year bid. And so this year, I split the bid between Cisco Foods
okay.
and Thurston.
And Thurston. Okay, so maybe let me ask the question differently. In talking with the students, because you want to have that lunch advisory committee,
mm-hmm.
what food would they be tasting? Would it be the foods that it's prepared, or what's coming from Cisco as far as their prepackaged or pre food that
No, we've actually done this before, mm-hmm. just never in recent years, not in any formalized setting. But we do what we call in the industry a cutting. So I would call Cisco, for instance, and I would say, okay. I want to do a chicken cutting, and I want to have these five high school kids come and do a taste test. They're not going to know the brand. They're not going to know how it's made, what it's made, you know, whatever. They're not going to know anything. They're just going to taste it and give their opinion.
Okay.
So what that Cisco is going to do is they're going to call the broker. So they're going to call the people that represent Tyson. They're going to call the people that represent Breakbush. They're going to call people that represent Jennie-O. And they're going to say, okay, Windsor Schools is getting ready to put their bid out. They want to see all your stuff. Show them what you got. And they all come in. They do the cooking. They prep it. They prepare it. They put it out. And then kids taste it. We did it 1 year. I ran out into the hallway again. I'm kind of a wacko sometimes, but I ran out into the hallway and I was like, come on, if you don't have a mustard ketchup, come and taste this food. We just got a bunch of food in and we're telling you, I want your opinion. The kids are like, what? And I'm like, come taste. Do you like hot spicy food? Love it. Come with me. I had like Pied Piper. I had like 8 kids coming in. Hey, free food, free food. I was like, oh my gosh, this is great. They tasted it. And I said, one caveat, I need your honest opinion. Don't tell me it's good just because you're hungry right now and you want to eat. Would you buy this? Mm-hmm. And they were so honest about it. It was fabulous. So that's what we would do. It's not stuff we're currently using because the industry changes all the time. Mm-hmm. They come out with new products, new this, new that. We just got a potato chip crusted chicken tender.
Ooh.
It's fabulous.
Potato chip crusted
chicken tender.
We seriously need to get
it. It's amazing.
To eat.
And it's bakeable. There's no
amazing.
It's so good. Okay. So we did it as a trial. We tried it at the school. The kids went crazy over it. So now I know it's gonna go on my bid next year. And we're gonna bring this in. It's yummy.
Is it called with Lay's potato chips?
I'm
struggling.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any more questions? Mr. Panos?
So say there's waste, for example, food. I assume that this is largely the vegetables that get thrown out, or what? Do you know?
Yes, I know. We do production records, and so we only cook what we know we need. Okay. So when I say when you say vegetable waste, there could be 3 cups, 4 cups of vegetables being thrown out at the end of a day, say at Oliver Ellsworth. Because they're not going to cook more than what they know they need.
I know. Okay. The child takes, you have this, you have to have a half a cup of this kind of green vegetable, okay, and thing. Now, do you know, how much is it, of that? So, they take it, you say, I assume you don't monitor, or do you don't monitor every time a child just throws it away?
No, but I go to the schools and I do go in the calf. I go in to see, my operation running, okay? I see the cooks and what they're doing and how they're serving and making sure they're giving the proper serving sizes. And then I meander my way through the calf. And I look in the trash and I walk around and I see and I might talk to kids and I might say, how do you like those green beans today? And they're like, oh, they're yucky. And I'm like, oh, they're going to make you bring in strong and whatever. And so you just talk to kids. And you see what they're eating. I mean, I don't stand over them, but I'm looking, And we have seen an increase in vegetable consumption. We have. I mean, as much as I was not happy about the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act, it is working. It's working. The kids love broccoli now.
Yeah.
Never thought I would ever say that. They love broccoli. It's crazy. So.
And you usually just, you cook it how? You steam it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's frozen.
I have a hard time eating it too. you could put braise some onion in the bottom, put some olive oil in there.
Nope, can do. And all the calories and fat, it doesn't fit.
Well, that's not the problem with calories. That was another thing here. I noticed you have the skim milk.
Uh-huh.
And you're not whole milk.
Nope. Not allowed to have whole milk. We cannot have it.
Oh, that's the best. That's where all the all the vitamins are and controls a person's appetite, I think. So, I was a little surprised to see that you have the healthy hunger free. I guess the general question is how much subsidy do you have total? It looked like the one program there that you were in, the clock or whatever it is, seemed to give a lot of the money. Do you have the total amount that you receive, approximate, that is from the USDA and the rest? What is the percent?
You have
a price of what, $2.75 a meal, or it depends on where you are?
$2.50 in the elementary, $2.75 at the middle, and $3 at the high school.
Okay, so of one of those, let's say the $3 at the high school, how much of that is a subsidy? I mean, that's the cost. That's what the child pays.
Right.
But the cost is more than that. What does it really cost?
Well, they give us 26 cents a meal, additional.
Okay, so.
USDA knows to produce a school lunch in Connecticut. There's been all sorts of surveys, studies, and everything. Is well over $3.50 to produce a lunch that we sell. We just went up this year for $3. So we are behind. Every single meal we serve, we're behind. So that's why we do a la carte things. That's why we do catering function. That's why we, sell beverages. It's to just break even, to try to just keep status quo. So it's, you can't charge that much, it is what it is. So we were able to go up. We were forced to go up this year. USDA said we had to go up, and we did.
So the vast majority of the $3 of the cost is borne by the student pay. It's not a small amount. And the vast majority of the cost of the meal is in the money given to you by the student.
For a paid student, yes.
Yep.
For a free student, we get like $3.28 or so for every meal. So, for instance, the month of September, we are going to receive, for lunches, reimbursement, $108,000 for the month of September for lunches served, just lunches. So we're in operation 10 months, so we're getting over $1 million a year in subsidy. We're about a $2.5 million operation right now. But that's just lunch.
I was just curious, in the map that you gave, the Connecticut school district participating in the healthy food certification, what are the criteria and why would someone not join?
For the healthy food certification?
That
mm-hmm. The map
yeah. You gave out here, it says somebody joined this.
The reason you would not join is because you can only sell things that the state of Connecticut has deemed sellable in your school to get the funding. So that means everything you sell has to be under 35 grams of fat, sugar, and sodium. 35, 10, 35, okay? Under 10 grams of fat, 35 grams of sugar, 35 grams of sodium, okay? For a single serving. So that means I can only sell students baked chip products, baked, okay? I can't sell regular Lay's, and I'm happy to do that, very happy to do that. I think it's all what you get used to. The districts that have opted out make way too much money on students that want full fat cookies, like the ones over here, instead of the ones we serve are whole grain, reduced fat, reduced sugar. Still satisfies the cookie craving, but it is a healthy cookie.
So the potato chips that you serve are all baked?
All baked. Yep, all baked.
And the cookies and things like this?
Whole grain, low fat, low sugar. So, there's a compromise. We prefer to keep the theme healthy in our district. The districts that opted out said, you know what? We want the money. It's not a good message, I don't think. But
It's not mine to make.
Give us an idea how much in terms of soda you sell?
No soda. We have never sold soda, ever. State of Connecticut does not allow soda at all in schools, state of Connecticut. Other states do. They still do.
Do you have any sugared drinks?
100% fruit juice is all we are allowed to sell. Connecticut, again, has a very strict beverage standard. And so we sell something called, I should have brought one, we sell something called Switch. And it kind of looks like it's like you know how the Red Bull container, round, cylinder, tall, skinny, right? It looks like that. It's 100% fruit juice and carbonated water. But it is 100% fruit juice. The kids love it. They think in their brain, they think it's soda. It's not. It's juice. And it can only be a 10-ounce serving. Can't go any more than a 12-ounce serving for Connecticut statutes for beverages. So no soda ever. We can't even just sell Gatorade.
Can't even sell what?
We cannot sell Gatorade. No nutritional value in Gatorade. Everything we sell has to have nutritive value. It's very complex. Our whole food service
like,
operation is very...
things called chicken popcorn or something like this. What is that? You know, the little chicken
popcorn
nuggets
chicken?
And stuff like that?
Yeah, it's small. Little small pieces of white chicken that's been, you know, breaded in whole grain. And it's baked.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And it's baked, okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
Yep. We haven't used a fryer in Windsor High School in, 8 years, 9 years.
So you don't fry anything?
Nothing. 8 or 9 years. We have the fryers there from when the renovation was, and I am happy to donate them to one of the fire companies wanted them. And I'm happy to donate them.
Well, okay. You guys have a lot of them.
Oh. We do. We need more.
Right.
Because, you know, I'm sure all the gaskets and everything are old and whatever, so it's going to be overhauled.
That's okay.
But they are just collecting dust. We don't fry anything. Mr. Bosch?
Well, I'm just getting hungry sitting here, to be honest. But
I do have
a question, and it's a it's an open-ended question. I know I've been asking a lot of specific questions, but if there's one thing that would make your job more enjoyable, easier to do the way you want to do, you know, it might not be something that we have the power to change, whether it's the USDA that would change it, us, the parents, the students, your staff. Like, what's one thing in your mind that would just make it easier for you to serve food the way you want to serve food?
I could be here all night answering that question. But I know I've gone very long here. So I think the one thing that bothers me the most about the entire program, I will never forget, I was at a fundraiser at Windsor High School, and I was volunteering, and I went to the fundraiser, and I was cooking something or serving something or whatever, trying to, you know, help out in the fundraiser. And a parent didn't know that I was running the program. So she turned to me and she goes, "Oh, we're just gonna get the garbage that school food is." And I said, "Why would you say that?" She goes, "Oh, everybody knows school food is garbage." And I was so taken back by that, and that has never left me. The misconception that it's not good is, you know, that's the one thing if I could change, I would. You know, taste it, judge it. You know, now, okay, I'm gonna say, there's no salt added, it's all whole grain, so if you don't like healthy and whole grain stuff, you're maybe not gonna love it. But, and you know what, I like my cooking better. But I'm feeding my family, not the general public.
Thanks for that answer, and I wish everyone could kind of see, you know, what you brought there. I don't know if we could get that on camera for a minute for the public, just to see the foods that are out there.
Today. It's a lasagna roll-up, and it comes with 4 half-ounce meatballs, and a whole grain dinner roll, and a side salad. It came with fruit and a beverage, one of the 3 varieties of milk. This is a deli lunch. Comes with 2 sides of baby carrots, because they have to have one cup of vegetable. And it came with craisins. We needed to boost it with calories. We needed this for calories, not necessarily the fruit, calories. Come with whole grain, goldfish, and turkey, and low-fat American cheese. And a ranch dipping cup. And then this is a very popular lunch. This is the chicken Caesar salad. This is probably one of our most popular between the salad and the wrap.
whole grain breadstick, again, baby carrots, raisins, goldfish is, again, a grain, and a low-fat dressing. So these were all options today at the high school. But the misconception probably would be the thing I would like to change the most.
Thank you.
Any final questions from Mrs. Plant?
Question.
You mentioned like low sugar or no sugar and like no fat or low fat, and you did mention that you don't use artificial sweeteners. That's like against the rules.
Yes, we are not allowed to serve coffee, tea, artificial sweeteners, to the student population at all. There were some districts that had like a way to get around it. They didn't sell coffee. If you bought a bagel, you got a free coffee.
Gotcha.
And boy, oh boy, did they get in trouble.
Oh,
state found out and they were like, what do you mean you're serving coffee? We don't sell coffee. They don't sell coffee. They gave coffee away. So if you bought the bagel, you got the coffee. Kids didn't care about the bagel. They wanted the coffee. Like, talk about being, you know, what it, right?
So my question
sell, like,
is,
tea,
when you use like a low-fat dressing, do you consider the ingredients in that low-fat dressing? Because the concern that I have is like with all the artificial flavoring, with the dyes being linked to so many poor health outcomes, what does that process look like for you when you think about the ingredients for the products that you're purchasing?
We do look at the ingredient listing and we try to stick with brand names. We use Ken's products. Mm-hmm. And so Ken's is, you know, pretty good stuff and kids like it and it's cost effective for us. And more companies are trying to move toward more cleaner labeling.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're seeing, for instance, all the cereals we use in the elementary schools, General Mills and all, they're taking the dyes out.
Yeah.
There's no more dyes in those cereals anymore. They're using natural dyes, for the low sugar Fruit Loops or, you know, whatever it is they're, you know, producing. So we are absolutely looking at that at all times, yes.
Do the products that you were to purchase, are they allowed to have artificial sugars, or you're just not allowed to use artificial sugars?
State of Connecticut, USDA, does not allow it.
Okay.
We are not allowed to have any saccharin, artificial sweetener at all in any products that we sell.
Well, I'm really glad to hear that you are kind of looking at the products that you are purchasing with the ingredients, because that is something that I'm very concerned about as a parent, and just kind of watching the research come out on this, and over time, it does seem like Windsor is ahead of this conversation, so I do very much appreciate that.
Thank you. Okay.
Mr. Cattles? Can you serve butter, cold butter with the with bread?
No.
Question?
No.
No point eating.
Sorry. Sorry. All set?
Thank you, Mrs.
Thank you
very much.
You're welcome.
All right. Now are you going to take all those foods with you?
This is consumable, actually.
Okay.
It was under refrigeration. So you want the cold items?
Brian?
I think Ryan is.
There you go, Brian. You're so hungry. Go
for it. Don't be bashful now.
Can we take 5 minutes?
All right, moving ahead, we're going to, Dr. Cook. Agenda item number 4 is discussion of the budget assumptions for fiscal year 18. So I'll turn it over to Dr. Cook.
So yes, you have before you in our new process now that the full board is the finance committee, we bring forward the draft budget assumptions to the full board at this time. Usually it would be with the small group of finance committee, we talk about it. It would then, assuming all goes well tonight and we are bringing it forward, we bring forward the budget assumptions as a first reading at our November board meeting, and then the plan would be a second reading in December for the budget assumptions. So what you have before you tonight is 14 budget assumptions that we use to start our process and guide our process as we go through. Ms. Batchelder and I developed those. I have shared them with Mr. Lockhart in his role as Finance Committee Chair. And we recognize the board is seeing this for the first time tonight, but that's been our process in the past. So I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Batchelder, who will go basically line by line and share the assumptions with you, and I'll jump in throughout.
Okay. The first one is just our continued commitment to finding efficiencies in the budget, and we are constantly doing that daily. The second one is enrollment. We received our NESDEC projections the other day, and we are remaining flat enrollment going into 17-18. Again, that is just a projection. The NESDEC enrollment numbers in the past have not always been accurate because Windsor is a, you can't just use the state trends because of how many magnet schools we have, and we have seen an increase of kids come back, and especially this year we were very excited about the numbers from elementary to Sage and Sage to the high school increasing. So that was something that we're always looking at moving to next year and in future years. Our staffing and programs, we went through our budget process with all our principals and directors yesterday, and we they're fully aware of, you know, any different kind of staffing or program items coming down the line. We'll need a thorough explanation as to why and how it will increase student performance if there's something that is going to be added into our budget. Our class size, every year, and this is the Board of Ed, we will make every attempt to honor all of our class size and keep them as low as possible, but also being very aware of the economic times and if we need to add a classroom or decrease the numbers based on enrollment, we would do this. We would do such a thing. Number five, health insurance. This is actually the first year in my career that I can actually say that we're projecting to come in for 17-18 flat for health insurance. I've never seen that happen. We're usually between 5 to 10% increase every year just based on trends, but we've had a remarkable 3-4 years of claim experience. So we're really good in that department, and I'm happy that we can come in at a flat funded, because that is a big area if we need to increase. Contractual obligations, an average increase of 2.5%. That's for all of our contracts for teachers, admin, custodial, and so on. So on average, that is a 2.5% increase. Our special ed out of district cost for tuition, I'm projecting for a 3% increase. This, as you know, the past few years, this line item fluctuates daily, and I'm always monitoring it. The special ed department, Mr. Carvalho and I are always watching it, so this could decrease. It could increase, but it could also decrease as we're going through the next few months, because it is still early on in the year. Our utility costs, we've been doing fantastic in this district, in this town, for our utilities. We're all natural gas now. We have our solar panels. We were able to reduce our budget over $400,000 over the past 2 to 3 years just based on all of our efficiencies that we have put into place for our utility costs, and that is a direct partnership with the town and Board of Ed. We've done everything together with this area, and still looking to do more. We've already had a few meetings with the town manager and his staff on this. Our regular ed transportation, contractually, it's roughly 3.2% increase, which is about $128,000, and that's based purely on the contractual increase that we signed on for. The special ed transportation, this is one area that we really need to get in alignment. We have seen over the past few years that we do run into the hole in this area, and it is absolutely 100% based on need, but unfortunately or fortunately, we have to transport all special ed students, and we have to transport them in the way that they need to be transported, whether it's a monitor, a separate bus. So we have seen an increase in that over the few years of adding type 2 or vans for special ed kids. So this area has been in the negatives over the past couple of years. So it is my direction to hopefully increase it by $260,000. But again, between Mr. Carvalho and I, we were always monitoring this area. And also in trying to save costs, looking at surrounding towns, if we can cost share with other towns, if they're going to the same facilities, that we can ride share and split the cost. Our diesel fuel, I'm sure you all remember, this was a good thing for 16-17, but as much of a good thing of $1.49 a gallon. In my projection, I don't think it's going to stay. We're going to start the budget at $2.16 a gallon, which is what we had 2 years ago. But again, this line item can fluctuate, and we will be watching it. And this is in conjunction with the town. We lock in together, so they're really the main drivers, and they really watch the daily rate.
This is really, we have no say in that locked rate. That's really on the town side. The town is the one that does the negotiation, and the town locks it in, and basically we take what the town takes. Is that correct?
Yes, they do contact me, and they contact Dr. Cook when they're looking to lock in. They let us know the rates over in a couple of weeks down to a few days. They're in constant contact with us, but yeah, in the end, they're locking in. It's their contract. They're signing on the dotted line. The next one is magnet schools. I am projecting this is going to remain flat funded again this year. So that's a very good help for our budget. We have increased over the past few years. Other than this current year, we stayed flat funded. And my projection is we're going into next year. Number 13, our state and federal funding. Our excess cost and ECS funding is expected to remain flat as of today. This is an area that we're always watching based on the state budget. So whenever we get updates from the state, we're in constant communications with other districts to see how the percentage that they're going to budget for excess costs and ECS, and we all kind of work together to figure out what's a good percentage to come in at. So, and the last one is our Alliance grant. As everyone knows, we're in year 5 of our 5-year Alliance grant program. The newest update is that the Alliance grant is going to be funded like our title and IDA grants are funded. So it's going to come to the district directly and not through the ECS funds through the town. It's going to come to the district directly, which is a huge help for us. But it will probably be about a 5-10% decrease on our year 5 numbers.
So that's in a nutshell. Are there any initial questions on the budget assumptions? Ms. Rizzo-Holmes?
Thank you. Just a couple questions. Mm-hmm. On the out-of-district special ed tuition, mm-hmm. I know that fluctuates a lot. That's difficult to predict. So yeah. I hate to characterize it this way, but is that just sort of best guess?
Yeah. Okay. Every year, if you go back, we start at 3%. Mm-hmm. Last year we stayed flat. we were level funded because that's, you know, the we were trending really good. But I'm just a conservative. I like to be safe.
Okay, so
safer
that's just
than
sort
sorry.
Of the standard number. Okay.
And part of that might not be more students outplaced. It might just be the facilities raising their rates 3%.
Right, so and we've got no control
right,
over
right.
that. And then on the Alliance and the ECS, it seems like we're kind of in the same boat there as well, that we're, you know, obviously we're relying on the state for that. With the ECS funding, I'm trying to think back to for this year. I know did that fluctuate for other districts? I know it didn't for us, but it's my recollection that it did for some districts. I know it was proposed that it was going to fluctuate significantly for some districts, and then did that end up happening?
Right, so you'll remember at one point in the governor's proposal, he took ECS out of some towns completely.
Right.
He took that. When that came back in, there was a reduction pretty much across the board for ECS that they put into their formula and determine a funding amount for Windsor. But what the reduction to Windsor ended up coming through the Alliance grant rather than ECS. So our ECS stayed the same for next year. The Alliance grant was roughly $150,000 less. So that was their way to do that. Part of the reason why they did that was the MBR, the minimum budget requirement, stayed the same then for Alliance districts. So it was a way to protect some funding for Alliance districts.
Okay. Is there, do we really know for sure at all? You know, is there really any way to project? I mean, I feel like, at the state level, the budget has been such an issue,
right.
And going forward, we don't know what the governor may propose.
Yeah, no, you're right. When I talk to the state, they tell me they don't know, and this is a time I really believe they don't know. You know, they really don't have any idea where this is going. And I talk to our legislators, I think it's the same. But what I have heard consistently over the last month or month and a half was this plan, and Danielle's heard similar as well in her, her group's, that similar, that it looks like it would be going towards a Title I type grant where we would apply for it, we'd have to do tracking with it, and that we would continue to receive the funding. It's similar to what they've been telling us they were hoping to do over the years. So that is where I think we were, that's where other districts are as well planning on it. But they did tell us in a recent conversation to expect a 5-10% decrease.
Okay. I'm just wondering, and it's maybe early to ask this question, but given the way that things worked last year, where there, again, at the state level, there were a lot of budget difficulties, and there were a lot of changes from the governor's proposed budget to then what ended up happening. I mean, how do we plan for that? You know, what do we do when it potentially, those changes could happen, particularly on these items, ECS and Alliance, well after we may have passed our budget?
You know, I think it's similar to even in good years what we do. We bank on, a certain amount of money. I think we are conservative in terms of our funding estimates and where we think things are. It's that constant communication with the town. You know, in the past we've had good news to share with the town when we present the budget that costs have gone down. I think it's going to be a similar discussion this year. You know, there might be good news, there might be bad news. You know, the town itself has many accounts that they're out there with as well. I'm concerned, and you've heard us talk about it before, Magnet School. I know Nuchet has heard this from being on the CREC board as well, that their financial model, if the state doesn't increase the percentage they pay for Magnet schools, that may cause them to look to raise their tuition amounts. If that were to happen, and that's, we have some funding in here for that because we have less students there, but we were expecting that CREC will be looking to raise rates this year as well. So there is some funding in there for that, with also an anticipated drop in some students next year from CREC. So, I think over the years working through this, but it is a difficult budget at the state, and we'll have to watch that. I mean, the good news is we're still at November 1st. By the time that we're presenting the budget to the board in mid to late January, we'll have better information than we have today, and by the time the board has to set their budget in late February, we'll have better information at that point as well. But it's really never done, as you said, until it's finalized.
Thank you.
Mr. O'Reilly?
Yes, thank you. On number six, is that approximately $1 million increase?
Yes.
I just said that. Yeah, number six and seven and nine and 10 and 11 add up to be about $1.6 million.
Correct. Yep.
No, that's right. And as we start the budget process, what we're also doing, as you'll remember from other years, having conversations with principals to see if they're hearing from teachers retiring, changes that might be happening that could present some opportunities for what we call breakage, you know, that funding we might save when a teacher retires and we hire a new teacher. So that would offset some of that 2.5%. As well, there may be reductions that are made in staffing or repurposing, so we would look to mitigate that number. You know, Mr. Carvalho is already working on, you know, students that are outplaced, and as always, you know, seeing if there's potential to bring them back to one of our programs. You know, how many students are graduating from programs at the end of this year? So, you know, we're really working hard to offset some of those costs. You know, as Ms. Batchelor said, I've never seen a zero in health insurance as well. So that's a function of going self-insured, negotiations that the board is just undertaking with its, you know, biggest two of its biggest unions, its teachers union, its administrators. And so, you know, there's some savings there that we normally would be seeing a, you know, increase in health insurance. So that's some positive news. But you're right, we have some big numbers there to deal with.
And like Dr. Cook was saying, roughly, you know, the certified staff is about 950,000 increase. That's before retirement. So if remember last year, we had that reduction in our budget for retirements. We just made it this year. So I don't foresee it being that high, but that does not take into account retirements. That's just a snapshot of today.
Last year was 300,000.
Right.
Thank you.
Mr. Panos?
So when we say the base salaries are increased 2.5, that's not including the step?
That includes everything. Step, general wage increase. Okay. That's taking everyone today and what their salary is and what they will be next year, moving up a step, or just the GWI.
And just to clarify, you said that it was every unit, every employee, so that's total district.
Correct.
Are you all set, Mr. Rand?
Yes.
Ms. Fissel?
Yep, I just wanted to say that 14 is much more acceptable to me this year than the budget assumption on the Alliance grant from last year. I voted against the budget assumptions in both the first and second reading because I can't advocate as a Board of Education member for us to continue to receive Alliance District funding, which implies that we are continuing to remain an Alliance District, especially with how the state doesn't really have a metrics anymore for determining whether we're still an Alliance District. So I find 14, this 14 budget assumption, to be much more acceptable this year. And so just thank you for doing that.
Any other questions?
I would like to make a comment.
Yes.
I did have a meeting with Dr. Cook as finance chair, and believe it or not, I took a lot of the things that the Collective Nine liked and they didn't like, and worked with Dr. Cook on it. So I hope this is a clean document that you can take and review. I would humbly ask that you, if you have any questions before the next meeting on these, to get them to Dr. Cook so that he can be prepared to answer any of your questions during the first reading at the November board meeting. That will be in front of the public as well. I have spoken to Dr. Cook about the fact that we were blessed to have a budget that was fully funded for the first time in quite a while, and would like to see us meet all of our needs and try to keep the increase as minimum as possible. Is a zero possible? I do not think so, but I think the collective nine can come up with some type of a number that's agreeable to everybody once we get to that first reading. I do plan on having another conversation with Ms. Santos as well as Mr. Panos about where we think we should be going with this, so that Dr. Cook can have a good idea of where he needs to be. What I don't want to do is have Dr. Cook and his staff wasting time and chasing around the tree for something that's just not going to be pleasing the majority or even the minority folks at the table. So I'm looking for a very, very pleasant budget cycle like we had last time. I think we owe it to the town, and I think that we're at a place where we can do that and do it well. So I'm looking forward to working with all nine again, as well as Dr. Cook and the district on this budget.
Questions?
May I just ask,
on
the contractual increase rate, Ed, how many years contractual increases of the nature 3.2? This, of course, the 3.2% regular ed transition, the contractual increase.
Number nine.
Separate, right. 3.2%, did we have this for a couple, is it this high for a couple of years, or what's the story?
Yes, it's a 5-year contract, and it's that in the same increase each year. That's what we had asked for last year, if you remember, the same increase, so we're not going higher or lower in one given year. So it would be more equal each year. So we're not front-loading, you know, a 5% and then to have a 2%. We ask for a steady average.
And I just wonder what drives that much, 3.2%. I mean, it's a compounded that seems a bit high. I mean, mm-hmm. I know we agreed to it, but
yeah.
I'm just saying.
You know, it's interesting because when I was going through the bid last year, I actually reached out to a couple districts, and then it started this chain of emails through all of CASBO, and we're actually on the lower end of the daily rate for buses, which was really surprising to me. So most districts are actually higher as that daily rate, so we are fortunate to have a lower rate at statewide.
Okay, let me say, you're saying our rate is lower than normal, and so this is a form of trying to make up a bit for that? Is that
it? No. The increases are all the same, but that everything is based off the daily rate. And that daily rate for our to and from school and home is lower than the majority of towns in Connecticut.
Okay, well, maybe you can explain this daily rate to us someplace. It doesn't have to be here. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Ross, did you have another question?
Yeah, it's more of a reminder or comment on the point for transportation. I remember as we were going through the contract for DADCO, there was an opportunity for savings if we found parking in town. I believe that was after year two we would have that opportunity. I don't remember the specifics. And maybe you could remind us of the specifics of that. And I don't know if that's progressed, but there was that opportunity afforded to us that we talked about before.
Right. It was a facility. It was more than just parking. That was the majority of the acreage to be able to house all those buses. But it was after year two to have the town or Board of Ed have a space big enough to have the facility on one of our properties that we currently own.
Sure, and without discussing whether that's possible or not, if it happened, what would that be as a savings to us? What would we save from that opportunity?
I think we'd have to look at that again. It is a conversation we've had with the town when it happened as a possibility. I think it's a significant initial outlay for us compared to the savings, because what we'd be saving them is the rent that they're paying for the facility on on Dayhill, but the town would then have to have something. Ideally, this building here would have room for bus parking and, you know, a place for a dispatch office here. That would be, they'd be great, but, you know, you're talking about those beautiful soccer fields that are growing, and now that would have to become a parking lot, so I don't think that's going to happen.
Sure, it would just be worth knowing what the cost is, so we know if it's something to pursue or not.
Yeah.
I did have one question just to clarify on the special ed transportation and this anticipated increase. This is outside of our DADCO contract. What is the percentage? However, we do have special ed transportation within our contract.
Mm-hmm.
So is there, I just want, is that part of that regular 3.2% increase?
Yes.
So
that
special education transportation is absorbed into that 3.2 increase for our kids. You know what I'm saying?
No. We have, hang on a sec.
They are two separate line items.
Yeah.
So
in our transportation contract.
Correct. So some special ed transportation we do through DATCO, others we do through a Haven transportation.
Right, exactly.
Or other.
Right. So we have roughly 30 vehicles that are type 2, which are the small minibuses that, for the most part, in our DACO contract, for the most part, transport our special ed students within our schools.
Okay.
The special ed transportation line item that I'm referring to in number 10 is we have one vendor through Haven, which are our out-of-district facilities.
Okay.
90% of them. I mean, there are times that we need a wheelchair, DACO doesn't have it, we call on Haven.
Okay.
And vice versa, but that line item is out of district, not our schools.
Specifically out of district, and if there's any special ed transportation, it would be part of our regular ed contract for our kids in town.
Yes.
Okay. Any additional questions on our budget assumptions for fiscal year 18? Seeing none, again, I just want to reiterate our budget chair's request that if you have questions related to the budget assumptions presented this evening, that you, in advance of our meeting, so I would ask by Friday before, so that's Friday the 11th or so, before the board meeting of the 15th, you submit the questions to Dr. Cook so that he and his staff have time to get the answers for us on Monday the 14th and Tuesday the 15th to be able to answer our questions at our first reading at our November board meeting. Moving on to agenda item number 5, I have no announcements other than we have our next meeting, just as an announcement to the public, that Windsor Public Schools is in session on Friday, November 11th. We do have school on Veterans Day, so I just want to ask the families to just be aware that our students do go to school, and I do believe all students, all schools have events going on. So stay posted, and I hope that you can participate with the school district in those special events. And again, to thank our veterans for their service. Moving on, and I just want to remind the parents, again, who are watching live or taped, there is no school a week from today on Tuesday, November 8th. That is professional development for the teachers, and the children are not in school next Tuesday for Election Day. And that's it. Ask for a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
Second, Mr. Panos. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention? That moves 8-0. Meeting adjourned.